Hi guys, and welcome in this presentation. I'm Anthony.
And I'm Adrien.
And today we're going to talk about our latest CVPR paper. It includes a lot of very interesting topics such as temporal segmentation,
action spotting,
and highlight generation.
Let's go! Context-aware loss function for action spotting in soccer. Videos. In this work, we chose to tackle one of the greatest challenges of our time in computer vision and deep learning, video understanding, and more precisely, action spotting.
One of the most representative datasets for this task is SoccerNet. And to present it, no one is better than its original author, who happens to be a collaborator on this paper. He is live from Saudi Arabia. Hi Silvio, great to have you. Could you please tell us more about the SoccerNet dataset and the action spotting task that you created?
Hi Anthony, hi Adrien. I'm glad to be here with you today. We published SoccerNet at the CV Sports Workshop in 2018 during CVPR. We built our dataset to tackle the task of action spotting, with a particular attention to soccer videos. Our dataset is composed of 500 complete soccer games broadcasted from the major European leagues and the prestigious Champions League. Imagine, that's more than a mouthful of videos, all annotated with more than 6,000 game events, such as goal, cards, and substitutions. In SoccerNet, we introduce the task of action spotting. The objective is quite simple, retrieving the exact time when those actions occur. Previous works localized activities defined with a beginning and with an end. But in soccer, those time boundaries are quite blurry and quite subjective as well. When does a goal start? When does it end? We don't know. We believe a goal actually occurs instantly, at the exact moment the ball crosses the line. That's how a goal is defined in the rulebook. We believe that spotting those instantaneous events could even help understanding video in a more generic setting.
Thank you for your expertise, Silvio. Let's now get back to our paper. Ladies and gentlemen, in this video, we'll explain the steps of our action spotting pipeline. First, we model the natural context surrounding the actions. Second, we incorporate this knowledge into a novel loss function that performs some temporal segmentation. Third, we design an action spotting module to detect the actions based on this temporal information. Finally, we'll show that we achieve some very impressive results. We even have a little extra application for you, so make sure you stay until the end.
Okay, let's start with the basics of this paper, the temporal context. To leverage the natural context surrounding the actions, we start by defining 6 temporal segments around each ground truth action spot. Far before, just after, far after, and some transition areas. They constitute our action context slicing, and they will be used later on to induce specific behaviors in our loss. Nevertheless, all the frames contained in these temporal segments have the same default label, 0, because they do not correspond to an annotated action frame. This is problematic. The frames located just after the action and the one located far after the action clearly carry different information about that action, despite having the same label. Hence, we transform the frame labels into the time shifts between the frames and the action. Now, the annotation is much richer, and our action context slicing is delimited by context slicing parameters. This process is performed for each class of action to identify.
Okay, now, where are we going with this timeshift encoding and context slicing? We use the context slicing to define a general behavior for a loss function in each temporal segment, and we use the timeshift encoding to parameterize the loss accordingly. This means that we design a loss function that penalizes differently the predictions of the network depending on the frame analyzed. Let's explain more clearly. For the frames far before or far after an action, we train our network to avoid predicting an action. That makes sense, right? Thus, if P is the actionless prediction, the loss will be minus ln of 1 minus P. Now, for the frames located just before an action, we cannot predict if the action is going to occur. Think of a player approaching the goal. You cannot know for sure if he is going to score. Hence, we do not penalize the network. Zero loss. It can predict whatever it wants. However, just after the action, the network must still be able to identify its occurrence, and this fades away as time goes. Thus, we design the loss such that it smoothly goes from minus ln of p for the annotated frame to zero, using the time shift encoding S to parameterize this evolution. Finally, the time shift encoding parameterizes the loss in the transition areas, such that the loss is continuous between the temporal segments. Finally, our loss looks like this.
Great, but what happens when several actions of a class occur during a video? For example, several goals. Well, the time shift encoding for the frames located between the two actions are roughly the time shift from their closest action, possibly adjusted so that the loss is smooth. Here is where we are so far. The network takes videos as input and gives, for each class, an actionless prediction score for each frame of the video.
This means that we still need to perform the action spotting, our target task, remember? We split our videos in chunks. For each chunk, we try to spot the actions that it contains, if any. The actions are encoded in a YOLO-like fashion with a set of vectors, one per action, limited to 5 actions per chunk. In the vectors, we encode the presence or absence of actions, their locations within the chunk, and the class of the actions.
We ask our network to output 5 action vectors per chunk. We leverage an iterative one-to-one matching to pair each prediction with a ground truth vector based on which has the closest location in the chunk. The action spotting loss between the predictions and the ground truth vectors is then computed as a weighted sum of the squared errors. Here is our final network structure. The spotting module uses the previous context features and outputs the detected action spots.
Great! Now that you know everything about our network, loss function and training, let's get a look at the main results. On the SoccerNet dataset, we beat every other method by far, which is awesome. But of course, this is just a global metric, so let's analyze the output of our network in detail to see the strengths and weaknesses of our model. First, we can take a look at the same metric for each class. The goal class is the easiest to retrieve, followed by the cards and the substitutions who have similar lower performances. Cards and substitutions are more difficult to spot because these actions are much shorter and are not often clearly shown on TV.
And we can also take a look at the evolution of the performance throughout a regular 90-minute game. As you can see, the number of events shown by the blue bars increases through time. The performance, shown in orange, decreases around halftime. This is usually because some substitutions take place during halftime and are not shown on TV, but are annotated in the dataset. Finally, here is the performance of our network as a function of the proximity of the events. For example, if you get 2 cards in a row. As you can see, as the proximity increases, the performances drop. This indicates that some improvements are needed to better detect very close events. This could potentially increase the overall performance of our method. Ladies and gentlemen, globally, we spot most action within a 10-second range around the ground truth, which is incredible.
But wait, there is more. I told you spotting could help localizing activities in more generic settings, right? Well, the state of the art on ActivityNet, BMN, actually relies on action spotting. It spots the exact time an action begins and an action finishes. We injected our new context-aware loss in their pipeline, and immediately we saw an increase in performances. We have not changed the architecture, We have not increased the number of parameters, we have just added the context information in the loss while training. Amazing, right?
Thanks, Silvio. So, I guess you've waited long enough for our extra application, right? Time has come. For that, let's get back to our soccer dataset and check the output of our network on a single game. In these graphs, we plot the actionness score in orange, the ground truth in blue bars, and the detections with the green stars. Everything seems to work fine. We have a majority of good detection around the actions, with sometimes some false positives or false negatives. But then we noticed some irregularities in the actionness score. At some point, the actionness score increases for one class without giving a detection. So we took a look at the original video at that moment.
All the spikes from the goal class correspond to goal opportunities, and the majority of spikes for the card class correspond to unsanctioned faults. This is an amazing result, as these events are not annotated in the dataset, and we now have a way to retrieve them. Our network sees that these actions share similar features with the annotated classes, but are different enough not to trigger a detection. This is all thanks to our loss function. As a use case, we choose to produce automatic highlights, as these kind of actions, along with the cards and goals, are often selected. By simply cropping the video around the detected actions and the peaks corresponding to unannotated goal opportunities and unsanctioned faults, and stitching the clips, we can simply create some highlights of the game.
So amazing! Let's now recap what we've seen in this video. Our objective is to retrieve action spots in untrimmed video sequences. To do so, we model the context surrounding an action. The labels are transformed from action spots to time shifts. This defines different time segments around the action. Based on these segments, we design a temporal segmentation loss that smoothly imposes a high segmentation score after an action occurred. Guided by this loss, our network extracts features from the video up to the segmentation module. Then, the spotting module predicts the classes and the exact frames of the actions. The results are impressive. On the SoccerNet dataset, we beat every other method by far, and we also show improvements on ActivityNet. Besides, our loss allows us to do more, such as automatic highlight generation.
That's it for today. Thank you very much for watching. We hope you enjoyed this new presentation format. Feel free to contact us if you have any questions, and see you next time.